Yes, today I'd like to report the ULF waves observed by Apollo lunar surface magnetometer data. I'd like to thank immensely Dr. Palmer Dial, who is in the audience, I believe. He provided or he made possible this a wonderful experiment on the surface of the moon. And also, I'd like to thank Dave Williams at NSSDC provide the help for data recovery, and also Chris Russell at UCLA for all the comments. So first of all, for those who are not in space physics field, I'd like to just to briefly describe this ultra-low frequency waves, which are the waves I spent quite some time studying. And these waves are basically the electromagnetic waves with frequencies at 1 hertz or below. You can even go down to essentially zero or close to zero frequency. It's a very low frequency perturbations. And what does the frequency band covers are all kinds of oscillations due to, for example, ion gyration in the plasma or the normal mode oscillations of the magnetosphere. It could be something from the solar winds, for example, the Alfvén waves in the solar wind, and even people have discovered that through these observations, you can also find out the global oscillations of the sun with the same frequency in the solar wind. So basically, observing these waves have very useful implications on various processes in the space environment, and we can use them as diagnostic tools. At the lunar orbit, several authors have reported the observations of ULF waves. For example, Bill Farrell and colleagues using wind data show as a consequence of the ion cyclotron waves in the foreshock region when the spacecraft was at the in the wake of the moon in the solar wind. And also Kaguya satellites also found these high frequency, high frequency that is close to the upper bound of the ULF band. These waves are also observed by Kaguya. I'm focusing on the waves observed by Apollo experiments, including the lunar surface magnetometers, and also the magnetometers on board subsatellites. I have to point out that LSM was built at Ames by Dr. Dial here, to me, it's a great achievement in a scientific experiment, because that was the first time human being, set up surface measurements of the magnetic field. So, and even though later on there were measurements of magnetic field by orbiting satellites, but since then we haven't gone back to the surface of the moon to measure the magnetic field over there. So this Apollo data set is really unique even to now. And I just want to show the coverage, and we have LSM from Apollo 12, 15, and 16, and also the subsatellite measurements on the Apollo 15 and 16. So there's some overlap with other satellites near the lunar orbit. Now there's an additional data set archived at the Federal Records Center provided by Dr. Dial that we're still trying to get a hold of the data, and we have discussed with Greg Smith yesterday at a very productive meeting that we're going to move forward on that. So I'll skip this, but basically we restored some data that are currently archived at NSSDC, and yeah, of course, I haven't been able to recover all the LSM data archived at NSSDC, but with a small set of data, I have found this interesting ULF waves close to 1/10 of a hertz in the Manito tail. So these are what they are like. If you plot in terms of power spectrograms, these are narrow band frequencies. And the black line here, is, and we're plotting 6 hours of data here, and this is, goes up to the Nyquist frequency of the data. And the black line here is the proton gyro frequency. So you can see that these little wave packets have a frequency very close to proton gyro frequency. And there's some. Sometimes we see that the rising tone in this ULF waves, but each wave packet is usually that for several minutes at most. And sometimes there are very high frequency, close to a Nyquist frequency. But at this point, we haven't really decided whether or not to analyze them because they're so close to Nyquist frequency, and it's possible that this is aliased from the waves with a frequency even higher than Nyquist. Of course, in the Manito sheaths, we see broadband waves, and this is what we expect. And you can see that this proton gyro frequency, varies greatly, that reflecting the magnetic field variation in the sheath. And in the upstream region of the bow shock, we also saw broadband perturbations, and we believe those are the ion cyclotron waves reflected by the at the bow shock, as reported by some other authors. So that when we take a look at this narrow, let's go back to the narrow band waves. So when we look at this, and we plot the wave polarization, we can find that they are basically circularly polarized and left-handed. So it's very consistent with ion cyclotron waves. And this event, the field, background field is pointing outward. And also you have this waves basically in the plane tangential to the lunar surface, and I think basically it's it seems like there are ion cyclotron waves coming down to the moon from somewhere closer to the Earth, but since the Manito tail, the field line is pretty horizontal, and that can last for a long distance. So it is possible that the source is located somewhere between the Earth and the Moon. And at this point, we haven't been able to find out where the a source location is, because it's just a wide range of possibility. But this is something that I don't think other observations in space have discovered, because I think at the Moon, it's 60 REs down. In the Manito tail, it's not somewhere that many spacecraft go to, except for several lunar spacecraft. At the end, I'd like to say a few words about Manito sounding of internal structure. This has been a very important topic in the past, but during the Apollo era, and I I think there two methodologies were used at that time. I think one is from two spacecraft using one surface magnetometer data and also the data from orbiting satellite. So by doing that, you can compare the field perturbations external to the moon and also surface measurement providing the external field plus the induced field by conductivity inside the moon. But there's also a single spacecraft technique that the UCLA group try to use the most. I think it's just to get a I think and people came to a conclusion that it must be a dipole moment inside the moon at that time. But I think at this point, I think we're trying to get back to the Apollo data. My personal opinion is that these two different types of observations can really help each other. So I think in the 1970s, Dr. Dow and others already have great ideas. But I think there seems to be more to do to put together this surface and orbiting measurements, and we can perhaps we can do more calibration between the different instruments and also spacecraft measurements, and then we may be able to provide better accuracy in the conductivity calculation. But at this point, I think what I hope to do is to start with intercalibration between LSM and subsatellite magnetometer data. So we have already had several time intervals where we see that the measurements are pretty comparable. Kind of suggesting that data restoration the reading of the data is correct, and the next step will be to calibrate these data set if necessary, or before we move to the analysis of the conductivity of the moon. So I'll close with this, and thank you.
For the wave activity upstream of the bow shock, is there a correlation between IMF orientation and the activity?
I think the location, I think we haven't got so many examples just yet to find it out, but the case I looked at, it is consistent that it is in the foreshock region.
Okay.
I think I forgot to point to the location of the moon. I think this event is when the moon was over here, and that's pretty pretty much in the upstream region.
Okay, so you would expect you're magnetically connected to the shock and
yes, okay. Yes.
Okay, great, thanks.
I'll take chair's prerogative to ask one. Part of your slide got cut off at one point, but you think that an orbiting magnetometer could actually measure the induced magnetic moment from the core? Did I understand that from one of the slides?
Yes.
Cool.
Right.
Yeah, would be
particularly. In fact, I think using single spacecraft, Chris Arso already did a thorough analysis using data and calculated the dipole moment. However, I think it is kind of has an implication that it could be a metal core, but it cannot provide a proof, of course. So,
but still be surely interesting in combination with GRAIL results. Yeah. So, I always hate doing this, but I think we do need to move on to stay on schedule. So, let's thank Peter again.